One will arrive there in the capital, along wide avenues containing the triumphal arch, the pantheon of the army, the square of the people, things to take your breath away. Let it be built on such a scale that St. Peter's and its square will seem like toys in comparison. Those who enter the Reich Chancellery should feel that they stand before the lords of the world.
This was Adolf Hitler's grandiose vision for Germania, a kind of hyper-Rome to be built on top of Berlin as the new capital of his thousand-year Reich. In the end, Tempelhof Airport was one of the few of these edifices actually to be built here. It gives us a glimpse of an empire that might have been. From here, Hitler intended, the Aryan race would rule over vast tracts of Lebensraum, living space. Scheduled flights would allow the elite of the master race to fly from the capital to the Ukraine in a matter of hours. Thousands of miles to the east, Hitler's allies, the Japanese, were busy building their own version of Lebensraum, carving out a vast new empire in China and Southeast Asia. Together, Germany and Japan were creating a new world order in which the Aryan and Yamato peoples would be the masters. Their megalomaniac visions came much closer to being realized than most people like to admit. Between 1937 and 1942, no army seemed able to withstand them. The 20th century was a 100-year conflict, a war of the world. By its midpoint, it was these bold new empire states, with their racial theories and totalitarian methods, that seemed poised to win it.
1942 was the year the world teetered on a knife edge. It was the year the whole map of Eurasia appeared to have been redrawn. From the Rhine to the Volga, from Manchuria to the Marshall Islands, huge tracts of land had changed political hands. Now, in the name of living space, they were to change populations too. But the methods the Axis powers used to build their empires meant that living space soon turned into killing space.
This is the Yasukuni Shrine in Tokyo, which houses the souls of the 2.5 million service personnel who've died in battle since the 1860s. Every year, 6 million Japanese come here to worship those who laid down their lives for emperor and country. Among the officially enshrined martyrs are 14 Class A war criminals. One of them is General Iwane Matsui, commander-in-chief of the Japanese forces in central China in 1937. Matsui was subsequently tried for his involvement in one of the most horrific atrocities of the Second World War. The Rape of Nanjing. From the moment full-scale war broke out between Japan and China, General Matsui's Imperial Army inflicted defeat after defeat on the forces of the Chinese leader Chiang Kai-shek. But the fighting was harder than they'd expected. In the hope of ending the war, the Japanese determined to make an example of Chiang's capital, Nanjing. As they fought their way along the road from Shanghai, the Japanese soldiers provided a foretaste of what was to come. They indulged in killing competitions, which were covered by the media like sporting events. On the 7th of December 1937, this headline appeared in the Tokyo Nichi Nichi newspaper.
Sub-Lieutenant Mukai Toshiaki and Sub-Lieutenant Noda Takeshi, both of the Katagiri unit at Kuyang, in a friendly contest to see which of them will first fell 100 Chinese in individual sword combat, are well in the final phase of their race, running almost neck to neck. Sunday, the score was Mukai 89 and Noda 78.
As news of the approaching Japanese army reached the city of Nanjing, the Chinese authorities decided to shut all but one of the gates in the wall that encircled the city. In a vain attempt to keep the marauding invaders out, they ended up locking the defenseless inhabitants in.
The Japanese 10th Army, under the command of the Emperor Hirohito's uncle, Prince Asaka Yashihiko, arrived here at Nanjing city walls on December the 8th, 1937. The 30,000 battle-weary but still bloodthirsty troops quickly surrounded the city, though before they sealed it off, the Chinese leader Chiang Kai-shek was able to make his escape. 5 days later, the Japanese broke through the city gates. What they found inside was a ready-made abattoir.
Prisoners were murdered in their tens of thousands, bayoneted, beheaded, and buried alive. And not only military prisoners, the violence swiftly became indiscriminate. Asked by a journalist to justify what had happened, Lieutenant Colonel Ryukichi Tanaka gave a chilling reply.
Frankly speaking, you and I have diametrically different views of the Chinese. You may be dealing with them as human beings, but I regard them as swine. We can do anything to such creatures.
As Stalin's henchmen were treating distrusted ethnic minorities in the Soviet Union, as the Nazis would soon treat the Jews of Europe, so the Japanese thought of and treated the Chinese as subhumans. There had been massacres in history before, of course. But there was something different about 20th century violence, apart from its sheer scale. Its spuriously biological rationale.
This capacity for regarding human beings as members of a distinct and potentially malignant species, not just as animals, but as vermin, was one of the reasons why 20th century extraordinarily violent. Only make that mental leap, and warfare ceases to be an encounter between two uniformed armies. It becomes a matter of annihilation, in which everyone on the side, men, children and the elderly, can legitimately be slaughtered.
Exemplary violence isn't just about killing. It's about humiliating as well. Events in Nanjing revealed another distinctive characteristic of 20th century conflict. That when violence was extended to civilians, it readily mutated into sexual violence. Perhaps the most striking feature of the attack on Nanjing were the rapes. Anything between 8,000 and 20,000 Chinese women were subjected to the most hideous sexual assaults, as one Japanese soldier, Takahiro Kozo, later confessed.
Women suffered most. No matter how young or old, not one could escape the fate of being raped. We sent out trucks to the city streets and villages to seize a lot of women. And then each of them was allocated 15 to 20 soldiers for sexual intercourse and abuse.
What are we to make of this behavior? Were Japanese troops somehow giving in to a primeval urge to impregnate the women of their enemy? Is it possible for men simultaneously to despise people as vermin and yet to desire them? Or was rape just bayoneting by other means?
The International Military Tribunal of the Far East found that General Matsui had failed to control his own troops in Nanjing. In 1948, he was sentenced to hang. The tribunal estimated that more than 260,000 civilians had died at the hands of Japanese soldiers in Nanjing, more than four times the number of British civilians killed during the entire Second World War. It gives you an idea of why, even to this day, the Chinese have not forgiven what was done during what the Japanese still call, with bizarre understatement, the China incident.
The violence of the Japanese forces at Nanjing was only the most extreme illustration of the contempt with which they regarded those whom they'd vanquished. What the Japanese were demonstrating was that brutality was a pretty effective basis for a new world order based on racial hierarchy and fear. That was something Europeans were to discover for themselves just 2 years later.
At 4:45 a.m. on September the 1st, 1939, the tranquility of daybreak in western Poland was shattered by a devastating aerial bombardment. An army of nearly 2 million men swept across the border from Germany. Just 16 days later, they had advanced hundreds of miles eastwards to capture the Brest fortress.
An army on a mission to acquire living space needed tactics not of protracted attrition, but of rapid long-range penetration. With its devastating combination of infantry, artillery, armor, and air power, that was precisely what the Blitzkrieg delivered.
Hitler had now added Poland to Austria and Czechoslovakia, which he'd acquired without firing a shot the previous year. Denmark, Norway, the Low Countries, and France would be the next to fall. Hitler's dreams of a European empire were rapidly becoming a reality.
The spectacular victories of 1939 and 1940 handed Hitler Europe on a plate from Poland to Paris. It was a bigger empire than that enjoyed by any previous German ruler. And yet Hitler didn't govern his new domains in a uniform way. France became a kind of economic milch cow crossed with a holiday camp for the Wehrmacht. But there was never any serious question of it ceasing to be France. It was a different story further east. The Slavic peoples of Poland and Czechoslovakia were regarded by Nazi racial theorists as inherently inferior. As when Japan attacked Nanjing in 1937, the German Blitzkrieg in Poland was accompanied by appalling atrocities against civilians and prisoners. This wasn't spontaneous. It was carefully premeditated.
It was here in the Bavarian Alps that Hitler and his cronies came to lay their plans for world domination. The location was suitably grandiose. Indeed, Hitler found the landscape at Obersalzberg near Berchtesgaden so inspiring that he called this his secret capital. Of course, he didn't stay in the brand new Spa Hotel that stands here today. When Hitler had come to Obersalzberg in 1925, he'd stayed in a humble log cabin. It was here that he dictated the second half of Mein Kampf, with its pledge to enlarge Germany's living space.
This place, Obersalzberg, was the playground of the Third Reich. They all came here. Bormann had a house down there, and Goering's was a little bit further back. And Hitler liked to walk from one place to the other. Now I'm sitting in a beautiful five-star hotel eating lunch, but I do feel just a little strange. Maybe because this comes as close as you can get to Hitler's ideal. This was where he held his Berghof, his mountain court. And I suppose it was from here that he and the other
masters of the master race were able to look down from a very great height on the rest of humanity.
The Obersalzberg was Hitler's ideal of living space in microcosm, a spectacular landscape, quintessentially Aryan, free of alien elements. On August the 22nd, 1939, Hitler had met his military leaders here at the Berghof, the grand residence he'd built with royalties from Mein Kampf. He left them in no doubt what the acquisition of German living space meant for the people of Poland.
Even if the war should break out in the West, the destruction of Poland shall be the primary objective. Have no pity. 80 million German people shall get what is their right. The strongest has the right. Greatest severity.
Ever since Mein Kampf, Hitler had conceived of empire in terms of murder and resettlement. Jews and Poles would either be killed or expelled to make way for German colonists who would go forth and multiply. These were the true priorities of the German Empire in Poland. The aim was nothing less than to redraw the ethnographic map of Europe, to turn the fantasies of a few racial theorists into a terrible reality.
Blitzkrieg had conquered Poland in a matter of weeks. Now it was time to realize his dream by beginning the transformation of this newly acquired territory into living space for the German folk.
Huge elevated autobahn, and like this one, we're going to stretch from Berlin to Warsaw and on to Kiev. And along these, needless to say, in their Volkswagens, their people's cars, the members of the master race would travel in the direction of the cluster of fortified settlements that was going to be built between the Baltic Sea and the Crimea. And once they got there, they and their blonde-haired progeny would lord it over an enslaved helot people, purged of any undesirable racial elements, by a systematic policy of expulsion and extermination.
The mission of realizing Hitler's vision in Poland fell to its new Governor General, a Bavarian lawyer and ardent Nazi named Hans Frank. With the Polish army smashed, this ambitious man found himself in a position to decide the fate of 11 million people.
Aged 39 when he installed himself here at Wawel Castle, the historic seat of the Polish monarchy, Frank immediately became infected by delusions of grandeur. He told his wife she would be the Queen of Poland. The country itself would be the first colonial settlement of the German Reich, to be colonized by a new generation of Goths and Vandals.
"My one ambition," he declared, "is to elevate the Polish people to the honor of European civilization." The extraordinary thing is that a man who was both educated and cultured, who delighted in his new art collection, could regard mass murder as a civilizing strategy. One of Frank's first civilizing acts was to arrest and eventually murder 48,000 of Poland's intellectual, political, and religious elite. Next, he turned his attention to the Jews. As elsewhere throughout occupied Poland, the Jews of Krakow were herded into overcrowded ghettos, while the Nazi leadership decided what to do with them next.
It was as if the Nazis couldn't quite work out what they wanted to do more to the Jews. To get rid of them or to exploit them. As a result, the Jews of the Polish ghettos were left in a kind of limbo, simultaneously underfed and overworked. The so-called Jewish question was simply left unresolved for the time being, leaving the Jews of a city like Krakow a contradiction at the heart of Frank's Nazi empire. Instead, attention turned to the burning question of what to do with the Germans' newly acquired Lebensraum in the Polish countryside.
In the spring of 1940, Heinrich Himmler, who'd been charged with the forming of new German settlements, took a tour of the Polish countryside in his BMW, accompanied by his sidekick, Hans Jost.
Periodically, Himmler and Jost would pull over and stride out across the fields. According to Jost, Himmler would look out across the wide, wide space, which was full, abundantly full of rich, fertile earth. All of this was now, once again, German soil. Here, Himmler enthused, the German plough would soon change the picture.
Along the way, Himmler and Jost passed through the town of Zamoście. Himmler was so impressed with its dazzling Renaissance architecture that he decided to rename it. Himmlerstadt, as it would henceforth be known, would become the first foothold of the German folk on its new eastern frontier. The first phase of German colonization was straightforward. The town's Jews were rounded up to await deportation or execution. The next step was to get rid of Poles considered to pose a threat to the new order. Many were taken to the old fortification on the edge of town known as the Rotunda.
These cells were where the Nazis held Poles whom they had selected for execution. Later on in the war, it was a slaughterhouse with people being mown down indiscriminately. But early on, they chose quite carefully whom they wanted to liquidate. There were priests, lawyers, judges, businessmen, teachers. Anyone, in fact, who might conceivably be able to organize some kind of Polish resistance. They even executed Boy Scouts and Girl Guides here.
Among the earliest victims was 16-year-old Grażyna Kirchniewska, one of 36 guides and scouts shot by the Nazis as potential resistance leaders.
Now, with Zamoście cleared of its supposed racial impurities, only one question remained to be answered. Who would actually be the new German settlers, the bold Aryan pioneers, who would actually live in the space cleared by Hitler's armies? Rather embarrassingly, not many Germans from the Reich proper showed any interest in a new life in Poland. But there were other Germans elsewhere in Europe who were less reluctant to move.
By the summer of 1941, Himmler's commissariat had settled 200,000 Volksdeutsche, ethnic Germans from elsewhere in Eastern Europe, in Western Poland. 25,000 of them found their way to Himmlerstadt. This was a first step towards the racially pure Greater Germany of Hitler's dreams. But more high-quality Aryans were clearly required.
Himmler couldn't help noticing the rather large number of Aryan types among the Poles themselves. Indeed, there seemed to be more blonde hair and blue eyes than back in his native Bavaria. So as not to miss out on this valuable Aryan stock, the Nazis employed women, known as Brown Sisters, to patrol the streets of Zamosh offering sweets to likely lads and lasses. Those who accepted their hospitality were never seen by their parents again.
The Polish children who passed a variety of physical and psychological tests of racial value were sent off by Himmler to be Germanized in the fatherland. Just under 5,000 children from Zamoście made the racial grade. But 25,000 of the town's stolen children were deemed terminally Slavic. They were deported to concentration camps.
The Nazis found precious few collaborators here in Poland. Indeed, Zamoście became one of the centres of Polish resistance. But they got a warmer reception the further east they went as they entered Soviet territory. What nobody anticipated was that the biggest collaborator of them all would turn out to be the man actually running the Soviet Union.
Ever since Mein Kampf, Hitler had set his sights on conquering Russia. He blamed the Jews for the Russian Revolution. He despised the Slavs as Untermenschen. And he saw the vast plains of the Soviet Union as the ideal living space for the German folk. This made it all the more extraordinary that in August 1939, Hitler entered into a pact with Joseph Stalin to carve up Poland between them. Just days before the last Polish resistance was crushed by the Nazis in the west of the country, the Soviets rolled in from the east. Not long after the German panzers had reached Brest, they were joined by the 29th Light Tank Brigade of the Red Army. After the war, this mammoth war memorial was erected at Brest by the Russians. But in 1939, this place was the demarcation line between the new Nazi Empire and Stalin's Soviet Union. As the representatives of the two totalitarian regimes greeted each other, the scene had the quality of a mirror image. Despite their ideological differences, both seemed to treat the conquered Poles and to organize their empire states in much the same way.
After an amicable joint parade here in Brest's main square, the Germans withdrew beyond the River Bug, leaving the Russians in charge. On the Soviet side of the line, 13 million Poles, including a quarter of a million prisoners of war, were about to discover the distinctive charms of life in the workers' paradise.
Stalin's secret police soon began a campaign of terror against suspected anti-Soviet elements. The targets were landowners, businessmen, military officers, civil servants, precisely the kind of people the Nazis were liquidating in Western Poland. The aim on both sides was to decapitate Poland as a nation. Throughout the Soviet zone of occupation, the action was sudden and brutal.
The peace of Polish family life was shattered with a knock at the door. Without any warning, armed Soviet militiamen burst in, read out a deportation order, and gave families as little as half an hour to pack up whatever possessions the militiamen didn't help themselves to. Then the families were frog-marched to the nearest railway station and herded onto cattle trucks. Between February 1940 and June 1941, over a million Poles were deported eastwards in this way, the majority of them destined for Soviet labor camps in Siberia or Central Asia. Theirs truly was a journey into hell.
By 1942, nearly half of all the Poles Stalin had deported were dead. Small wonder that when Stalin looked over the fence and saw Hitler's ethnically cleansed towns like Zamość, he felt he recognized a kindred spirit. Here, truly, was a man after his own heart. A true totalitarian. A man who regarded the Poles as inherently suspect. A man he could rely on.
Stalin enjoys the just reputation of being one of history's least trusting, most paranoid leaders. Alexander Solzhenitsyn said he only ever trusted one man. Unfortunately, that one man was history's biggest liar.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome aboard the bus to the Kerstein House, known in English as the Eagle's Nest.
On April the 20th, 1939, Hitler had received an extraordinary 50th birthday present from Martin Bormann. With breathtaking views of the Nazi elite's Obersalzburg playground and the Berghof, this was the Eagle's Nest. To get Hitler there, Bormann had constructed a 300-yard tunnel which led to a sumptuous brass-paneled lift. This transported the Führer to what would literally be the pinnacle of his power. From here, the whole of Europe would lie prostrate beneath his piercing gaze. Sadly for Bormann, Hitler hated it. The tunnel and the lift made him claustrophobic, and the view from the top gave him vertigo. But in one respect, the Eagle's Nest provided inspiration in the form of its magnificent view of the mountain known as the Untersberg. Here, according to legend, lay slumbering the 12th century Emperor Frederick I, Friedrich Barbarossa. It seemed an appropriate name to give the most ambitious military operation and the most bloody act of betrayal in the War of the World. The greatest of all Hitler's collaborators was about to get well and truly stabbed, and not in the back. The oddest thing is that Stalin alone failed to see what Hitler's next move would be. It was perhaps the worst-kept secret of the 20th century. Among the dreaming spars of Oxford, hundreds of miles from the killing fields of Poland, people had a pretty good idea of what Hitler was planning.
This is the fellow's betting book in the senior common room at Jesus College, Oxford. On June the 16th, 1941, the then tutor in physics, Claude Hurst, made a bet with his geographer colleague, J.N.L. Baker, then a flight lieutenant in the RAF. The stake was one bottle of port wine. And the bet was that before noon Greenwich Mean Time, on July the 1st, 1941, German armed forces would have crossed the Russian frontier. It was a bet that the physicist won with 9 days to spare.
Nor was it only Oxford dons who accurately predicted a German attack on the Soviet Union in June 1941. Stalin's own spies sent him numerous warnings of an impending invasion.
All of this Stalin ignored. Typically, he scrawled in the bottom of the report from Prague, English provocation, investigate.
Here at Przemyśl, the River San divided the Nazi-occupied sector of Poland from the Soviet sector. And over on the Soviet sector, it was just another quiet summer's night. After all, there weren't that many Poles left to be transported to Siberia. It was the same story all the way up and down the border. Indeed, at one border post, the Russians actually invited German officers over to a dance they were throwing. The Germans politely declined. They said they had a rather pressing prior engagement.
The Russian troops in Brest had spent the day drilling to the sound of a military band. That night, as usual, they'd got drunk. As dawn broke, the regular early morning coal train from Germany arrived at Brest station. Suddenly, with no warning, the sealed cars opened and German machine gunners leapt out. This was Operation Barbarossa, the fulfillment of Hitler's pledge in Mein Kampf to seek German living space from the land in the east.
Operation Barbarossa was in many ways the supreme achievement of Blitzkrieg. By July the 9th, German forces west of Minsk had already captured nearly 300,000 Soviet troops. By the end of August, the prisoner toll stood at 900,000. From a Russian perspective, it was the biggest military disaster in history.
Yet it wasn't just living space Hitler was now pursuing. In toppling what he regarded as Jewish rule in Russia, he was paving the way for the solution to the question that for so long had obsessed him. But who exactly would implement this final solution?
When the first reports of the German invasion reached Stalin, he was at his dacha in the country. He was stunned. All Marshal Zhukov could hear at the other end of the line was Stalin's heavy breathing. Stalin just sat there. How could it be? How could Hitler, the man he thought he could trust, the man with whom he'd carved up Europe, have betrayed him?
For Stalin, the alliance between Soviet socialism in one country and National Socialism had seemed natural. But Hitler had made his real views clear to his military commanders on the eve of Barbarossa. The communist is from first to last no comrade, he told them. It is a war of extermination. In the first weeks of Barbarossa, the Germans summarily executed as many as 600,000 Soviet prisoners. By the end of the first winter of the campaign, some 2 million were dead. Altogether, by the end of the war, over 3 million Soviet soldiers had died in captivity, more than half the total taken prisoner. Once again, living space turned out to mean killing space. But now, on a vastly larger scale than before. The further east the Nazis advanced, the less discriminating their violence became. As for the Jews, the time had come for the logical conclusion of the Nazis' racial theory. If the Jews really were a species of vermin or virus, then the only definitive and final solution of the Jewish question would be their eradication.
Other people had committed genocide in the past, as Hitler well knew, including, some would say, Stalin himself. But there was something unique about the Nazi war against the Jews and against the other minorities they considered unworthy of life. It was the fact that it was carried out by such well-educated people, by the products of what had once been one of the most sophisticated societies in the world.
In the wake of the invasion of the Soviet Union, special SS units called Einsatzgruppen conducted the first phase of systematic killing. Later, however, such duties were given to ordinary police battalions. You didn't have to be a fanatical Nazi to become one of Hitler's executioners. As dawn broke on July the 13th, 1942, Reserve Police Battalion 101 arrived at the Polish village of Josefov. Major Wilhelm Trapp, the unit's commander, explained to his men that they were to round up the village's 1,800 or so Jews. They were to pick out the able-bodied young men who could be used as forced laborers or work Jews. They would then put the rest, the sick, the elderly, the women and the children, onto trucks and drive them to a quarry in the nearby forest. There, they would shoot them all.
The killing went on all afternoon and all evening. Finally, at 9 o'clock, the battalion returned here to the town square. In the grotesquely euphemistic language of the Third Reich, Josefov was now Judenrein. Cleansed of Jews.
Between the summer of 1942 and the autumn of 1943, police battalions like 101 were responsible for shooting approximately 38,000 Jews. Here was the reality of Hitler's dream of living space. Not the sumptuous architecture of Tempelhof Airport. Not the grand scenery of the Bavarian Alps. Just a sordid slaughterhouse in the backwoods of Poland.
I'm standing in the rain in this killing field trying to answer the old question, why did they do it? Were they just anti-Semites? Were all Germans so consumed with racial prejudice that they were just waiting for an opportunity to slaughter Jews? Or did they know that they were doing wrong, but somehow suppress their qualms out of deference to authority or maybe peer group pressure? There's a third factor I think we shouldn't rule out, and that is simple self-preservation. Operation Barbarossa was much more costly in terms of human life than any of Hitler's previous campaigns. Killing Jews was a soft option compared with frontline operations. And after all, what do old men, women and children have in common? They don't shoot back.
One thing, however, is very clear. The men of Reserve Police Battalion 101 personally knew few, if any, of their victims. They were in a war zone, in an unfamiliar landscape, killing alien people. But as the killing increased throughout occupied Poland, not knowing your victim ceased to be a prerequisite for murder. A 100 miles north of Josefov, the Jews of Jedwabne were killed by their very own neighbours, people they had lived alongside quite harmoniously all their lives. The village's 1,600 Jews were herded into the barn of the town baker and burnt to death. What happened in Jedwabne was by no means unique. Throughout the Nazi Empire, collaborators were only too keen to carry out the will of their racist masters. In parts of Romania and Latvia, the Jews were killed before the Germans even arrived. Lithuanians and Ukrainians, who hailed the Germans as liberators from Stalin's tyranny, eagerly lent a hand. In any ethnically divided society, one people will always be tempted to align itself with the invader, on the principle that my enemy's enemy is my friend. This was a key factor in the success of both the German and Japanese empire states. Their racial ideology was contagious. Most empires purport to bring peace and order. They may divide in order to rule, but they rule in pursuit of stability. The Nazi Empire certainly divided the peoples of Europe as it ruled them, but it brought no stability. On the contrary, the Nazis seemed to delight in sponsoring local feuds, so that the Second World War in Eastern Europe sometimes resembled a host of regional civil wars. But this pattern was by no means unique to Europe. In Asia too, indigenous collaborators were vital to Axis success at this stage in the War of the World. Even after the rape of Nanjing, the Japanese were able to find Chinese defectors prepared to run a puppet government for them. And when the Japanese struck south against the European empires in Asia, they found even more willing collaborators, who hailed them as Asian liberators, ending the era of Western imperialism. To the region's nationalists, Japan was the leader of Asia, the protector of Asia, and the light of Asia. The empires of Japan and Germany were not, as people sometimes assume, unwittingly bent on their own destruction, so irredeemably wicked that they were doomed to lose the war. Rather, they derived strength from the very ethnic dissension they fomented, from the collaboration they were able to elicit. So powerful were these two evil empires that you're left pondering one of the most deceptively difficult questions of the 20th century. How on earth did the Axis powers manage to lose a war that by the end of 1941, they seemed to have all but won?